questions, and how does education play in with that? I guess, so kind of a two-parter as far as the changes that are happening within the collection and the things that are needed to keep it current, all of the things that are involved on a daily basis, but then also the communication, like how do all of the staff members and volunteers learn about the new pieces in the collection, or if you know, there are pieces that have been in storage for a really long time and are out, so if anyone wants to take that on.
Who wants to take it on first?
We are a desert environment. We are an extremely dry climate. So that in itself is going to pose a challenge to any collection, and ours is no exception. So just in terms of maintaining stable humidity levels, particularly in the summer, can be incredibly challenging. When it comes to thinking about specific collections, say the water collection, for instance, it's not just scientific equipment you're working with, it's antiquated scientific equipment. So leather straps still powering the machinery, a lot of organic elements incorporated into these metallic ones as well. So ensuring that we have someone around who actually knows how to take care of that equipment, that can be a bit challenging as the continues to age and that generation dies on and so forth. You have to make sure that that information is maintained for future generations to keep looking after those particular objects. So that's kind of my answer to part one. And then I already forgot.
Seriously, yeah, just how do you get the information circulated through your staff and volunteers and anyone doing tours?
Excellent question. That's something we're always kind of reevaluating. As a whole, the museum is having to reevaluate its volunteer program, to be honest with you, because what I think a lot of museums are running into is that we have a pool of very dedicated volunteers who are getting increasingly older. So a lot of the volunteers we have at this point who have the time to come into the museum are in their 70s, 80s, potentially beyond. The main challenge we have at this point is attracting younger people to give their time to the museum, which is very challenging to do because we have jobs and so forth and other concerns, which leads to, you know, changing their hours and so forth. Because right now when we're open, most people are at work. When we close at 5, that's just when people are getting out. So a lot of, in terms of education, we're more focused at this point on how do we get with people in the door, and then we'll educate them from there. But in the past, when we had slightly more volunteers than we do now, we usually did it in a variety of ways. Sometimes during the monthly dose meeting, we would go in and give a tour of a new exhibition and so forth. Another way, too, is periodically rotating works in the collection, putting up a special label, or pointing it out to visitors saying, hey, this is the work of the quarter. Here's a piece that hasn't been on you in 10, 20, 30 years. Here's why it's cool and why you should appreciate it. And in terms of staff, I try to do the same thing, too. Set aside a day, either on Monday or close to the public, or some other time, just to take people through and say, all right, this is the new show. These are the updates on you. This is what I was thinking and why I thought.
So as far as challenges and maintenance and upkeep of the collections, there's two things. So I'm relatively new to the curating world. So when you are new to the scene and you have many previous curators and student workers, so we employ undergrads and fields from tech that work in the museum. So you basically are taking on all issues, and that can be a little crazy. And then also, we're at, I think, over 19,000 mineral specimens now. So being new to the collection, we go to shows and we're looking for things that we need for the collection, but without me, we need this. Do we have these cores from this Chinese locality? It's really nuts. But the successes, during the summer time, the school visits and people coming into the museum kind of slowed down a little bit, so they get a chance to kind of go back in and education of the collections among the staff and to the public. One thing I can say is that the undergrads that we employ, it's not all geology undergrads. So we have chemical engineering undergrads, and they're all science based, but they all get kind of geology, mineralogy education.
So I can share a challenge from one of my former jobs, which was actually at a mineral museum, where we had some pieces, and we also had some staffing changes and inherited some problems. One of which was we just had this mineral that was sitting in a box, white dust, and the picture that I had of it was this beautiful reddish orange with a high luster, gorgeous, and I was like, with these two things. It turned out light sensitive, UV sensitive, self-destruct, absorbent. Yes, and so if that was a challenge, and it took me quite a while because I was one of those students at that time, coming in not really knowing a lot about minerals at that point. So you really need to know your collection, and you really need to know some of the challenges that each piece is going to present. That was just one example, particularly about minerals, but you get the same thing with art pieces. The azure malachite polymorph. So if you're painting with azure back in the 1700s, now it's not blue anymore, now it's green. So your collections people need to understand that and be able to communicate that to people that it's like, no, that's actually not what the artist originally intended. There's some really excellent stories if you understand what's going on with your collection. But that does take research time, it takes people who are very interested, and it kind of takes a consistency among your staff. So that's some of the challenges. Successes come out when you really meet people who are passionate and care a lot about what's in the collection and spend the time to learn about it and want to share that knowledge. So how do we share that knowledge? Once we get some consistency amongst our staff, we'll be able to do that a little better.
I want to address this one too. Actually, this reminds me because today Mr. Zuhl, who's our donor of all of our pieces, he actually came to me and it's the second time he's come to me, and he's been really concerned about our geodes back there, the amethyst geode that's right in the corner. He was reminding me to make sure that he was really worried that it was going to fade. Already checked, their lights are LED, it's not going to fade. But it's the same thing, build your collection. Our geodes or amethysts, if you leave them, if they get too much sunlight, if they get too much UV, they're going to turn clear. It's not what you want for a geode, right? For one amethyst. It's not amethyst anymore, it's clear quartz. It's not what you want, right? So, or it's going to turn yellowish kind of color. So you'll get more of a weird citrine color. That's not what you want either, unless that's what you're going for, which they do. Conservation classes. You learn about conservation of art and pottery and all kinds of things. But one thing that I didn't really get a lot of background in was actually how to conserve my fossils and rocks and things, because like everybody says, when they come out of our museum, we're the rock museum, right? Everything, I'll ask kids a question about one of the pieces in our museum and they're answering, it's a rock. Yes, everything in our museum is a rock. That's the answer, right? So it's very difficult because that's what people think. Okay, they're rocks. Rocks are very sturdy, they're very stable, nothing's going to happen to them. They're totally not the case. Yes, our petrified wood is pretty sturdy, but even it can fade as well, right? So it's all a lot of challenges. And I understand the challenges with the keeping your staff up to date, because we don't have near the volunteers we need or the help I need. So hint, hint, anybody wants to volunteer for our museum, it'd be awesome. But the challenge that I've had is that I've actually had less of an older staff, an older volunteer base, and more of a younger volunteer base since we're on campus. I tend to get students, which is great, because they really actively so then you better retrain somebody else. And then so you get somebody just perfect, and then you get somebody new and retrain them, and they may not get it quite the same, you know. So that's always the challenge, I think, that I've been going through a lot. You know, I find my perfect intern and then they leave me. Alright, so especially blooming the Zuhl collection. So one thing that we do is I always have my students or my volunteers or anything shadow me on tours. So it gives a very, because it's very difficult to kind of give an overall explanation of our collection, because it varies. So having them shadow me on a tour really gives a good background of what all the pieces are and how I explain the pieces, what, you know, extra information, those kind of things, really give a better idea, and then just answering the tour's questions too, they get a lot more information on the collection that way. But it's great work with a very large collection. I'm sure you guys know to really get anybody to understand every single piece, right? You have to really go through. I had to do some research on a lot of pieces that I didn't really know anything about, and I have a geology degree. So. Sorry. Kind of go with the flow, I think it makes sense. Okay, we'll kind of go, since we've been talking a little bit about tours, we'll kind of go on this aspect. How does your multidisciplinary collection affect the styles of interpretation used in labeling publications and tours?
With our museums, when we get particularly large tours, three of our museums are right next to each other and one of them is a couple blocks away. But they're willing to bring an outreach table for extremely large tours. So when we do tours, they get not only a science or an art or a cultural tour, they'll get art history, they'll get everything. And I'm trying to theme that together to give them a memorable experience that actually makes sense is kind of a challenge sometimes. Two of our museums change exhibits so trying to get everything together with our tours to have it make sense requires a lot of coordination between all museums, the education staff, the curatorial staff, who knows more knows the exhibits better than us and has to teach the education staff. So that is definitely something that we work at very hard trying to make an experience that actually doesn't confuse our large tour people when they come through, or that's not jerky and jumping between the facilities, something that actually flows and makes sense together with them. So communication with that, that's just the huge important part of that.
So our museum's kind of like a self-guided thing. The only time we really have tours has been during the spring semester. A lot of the schools in New Mexico high schools, they'll come on admissions tours, so they bring prospective students through it. And we usually give them like a, you know, what's a mineral, ask them questions, and define it, and kind of set them loose with like scavenger hunts and be there, be a community. Not there for some reason, if Virgil, the director or myself, is not there, then people can understand where this is, where they come from, what's their people for, but hopefully they will see you very next much.
Sure.